May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our God, our strength, and our Redeemer. Amen. If I had to make a list of the difficult passages in Matthew's gospel, this one might make the top 10, I think. This is a hard gospel passage. I think it's hard for at least two different reasons. The first is that forgiveness is tough. Forgiveness requires something of us that makes us uncomfortable a lot of times. Forgiveness requires us to be humble. It requires us to be vulnerable. And that's just not something that a lot of us are familiar or comfortable with. The second thing that I think makes this a difficult passage is especially the last two verses. The last two verses of this passage challenge what I think is the very nature of God. I believe in a God that forgives and forgives and forgives, forgives all of our sins. And yet, this passage contradicts that. It seems as though there's a point in which when we don't forgive, there's judgment and the possibility of everlasting condemnation. And that's hard to wrap your head around. But before we get too deep into that, let's remember where we are in Matthew's gospel. If you remember, we're in chapter 18. This particular passage is the closing scene of chapter 18. And if you'll remember, last Sunday I told you that there were several themes that run through this particular chapter. The theme of humility, the theme of forgiveness, and the theme of what it means to live in community with one another and how we are to act with one another. So, now that we remember where we are, let's look at the passage a little closer. This passage, I think, can be divided into two sections. The first section is the brief exchange between Peter and Jesus at the very beginning. Peter comes to Jesus and he says, "Lord, if another member of the church sins against me, how many times should I forgive that person?" Now remember, sin just means to miss the mark. Sin means to fall short of expectations, to make a mistake, to err. So if another member of the church falls short of my expectation, how many times should I forgive? So you got to remember, during this period, there was a rabbinical teaching about forgiveness. The Old Testament says that we should forgive three times. There's another part of the Old Testament that says maybe four. So three, maybe four times is what the rabbinical teaching said. So Peter, being a good Jew, a good follower of Christ, takes that number that he knows that he's been taught, and he doubles it, and he adds one, and he thinks that's got to be the right answer. Jesus says no, not seven times, but 77 times. The original Greek here is a little bit odd to translate. It can be translated as 77. It can also be 70 times 7. Either way, 70 or 490, it's a pretty big number. It's a pretty big number to keep track of. Can you imagine having to forgive somebody and marking it in a little book? 1, 2, 3, all the way up to 490? But that's Jesus' point. Jesus' point is, it's not about the number of times that we forgive, that we shouldn't even be keeping count. Jesus is telling us that we need to adopt a posture of forgiveness, a posture of humility and vulnerability, to let go of those emotions when someone has wronged us or when someone has fallen short of our expectations. That's what the meaning of forgiveness is. It's letting go. But now the more challenging part, even more than that, the very nature of God and forgiveness. So Jesus goes on to tell a parable, the parable of the unforgiving servant. Now, we need to pay very close attention to the language here, because it starts off when Jesus begins to tell this parable, he's telling about this slave who owed the king some money. And when it says owed him some money, it says 10,000 talents is how much that this slave owed the king. How many thinks 10,000 talents is a lot of money? It is. It's a lot. Would you be surprised to know that it's not even a real number? It's like saying, you owe me a gazillion dollars. 10,000 talents was an astronomical sum of money. In the Greek language, 10,000 was the largest unit of measure. And a talent was worth a year's worth of pay. So what Jesus is saying here is that this guy owed the king 10,000 years worth of money. It's incomprehensible. But what that means is, Jesus is using one of his favorite devices to teach a story. He's using hyperbole. He's using outlandish language to try to reinforce a point. So right off the bat, we get the clue that Jesus is using outlandish language. This is going to be a story that's going to incorporate hyperbole. It's going to incorporate some things that maybe aren't literally supposed to be literally taken. So this slave owes this exorbitant amount of money. And he comes to the king and he says, King, have patience with me. I will forgive. I will pay you the debt. And the king recognizes there's no way that he can pay his debt. So he forgives the debt completely. Wipes it off the books. Just don't worry about it. And what's the next thing that this slave that has received mercy, that this slave who has been forgiven, this astronomical debt does? He goes out and he finds a guy that owes him money. Owes him 100 denarii. Now, denarii would have been about a day's wages. So this guy only owes him about 100 days' wages. A more realistic amount. An amount that he could probably pay back if given a chance. And when confronted, the guy uses the exact same language that the first slave used. Have patience with me. I will repay the debt. But instead of extending mercy, instead of extending forgiveness of that debt, the slave says, no, take him away. Throw him in jail until he pays the debt. It's an example of what happens when we hold on to emotion. It's an example of what happens when someone has wronged us and we hold on to that anger. We hold on to that fear, maybe, that feeling of being ashamed of being taken advantage of. When we hold on to that, that's what's going on here. So, we get to the very last two verses of this passage. And Jesus tells us that this first slave, when he didn't forgive, the king got angry and he sentenced him to be tortured. How does that reconcile with a God that forgives? How does that reconcile with a God that promises to forgive us our sins? All we have to do is ask. Jesus is dealing in hyperbole here. What if this is also a hyperbolic statement? I may be deviating from the text a little bit here, but I think it's helpful for me to understand what's going on. If Jesus is using hyperbole here, if Jesus says that God will be angry at you if you don't forgive, maybe what Jesus is actually saying is the same thing that I tell my kids when they don't clean up their room. I'm going to wring your neck if you don't pick up your room. Maybe that's what's going on here. Jesus is saying that God will be angry with you. Jesus is saying that we are called to take on a posture of humility, vulnerability, and forgiveness. And when we don't, we separate ourselves from each other. When we don't, we throw away the opportunity to be in relationship, in right relationship, with God and with each other. sisters and brothers, the reason that this passage is important is because it highlights for us the posture that God wants us to take with each other. It highlights the vulnerability that we need to show, the humility that we are called to show, to forgive when someone has wronged us. Sisters and brothers, I want to conclude with this one statement. If I have fallen short of your expectations, if I have erred, if I have missed the mark in any way, I'm sorry and I pray for your forgiveness. And I promise you, I will do the same for you. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.